Hey, it's time to start. Hey, no, can't be on the stage anymore. Well, I'm waiting for everybody to get situated and we'll get started. I know we don't want to hold up too long since we have dinner afterward and everybody gets looking kind of hungry about halfway through, you know. I don't ever want to get attacked or start throwing rotten tomatoes at me, so I don't like to go too long on dinner Sunday. Only 20 or 30 minutes over is what I try to limit it to, so. Did you all, were you awake enough when you got here this morning to see the outside, the front out there? Gary and Cindy and Sherry and Tammy. Well, I think Cindy said they were up here on Monday and Tuesday too, but they had kind of scheduled a day to work on the front and, you know, the gardens and took out some of the old dead bushes and all that kind of stuff, moved all those bricks. And those bricks that were sticking in around everything, they're pretty decorative. I thought they looked good out there. So they worked on that and all day yesterday, well, at least into the afternoon. I got here at 8. I was supposed to be here at 8, and they were already hard at work. And I don't know if they had rubbed dirt on them to make it look like they were just working hard, but I think they had been working hard. So, and then Gary and I came back. Alana was up on the ladder fixing the lights, and I was standing at the bottom helping her. And, you know, I would say, a little to the right, a little to the left, and she kind of got mad, and I thought she was going to throw one of those globes at me after a while. But anyhow, Gary and I came up and got the last one that was kind of stuck because the inside piece wouldn't hold still, and we got all the lights changed. So I didn't know if you noticed that when you came in. You can actually see, instead of having to count how many seats forward you wanted to sit in, you can see and the difference. Oh, did you have that picture then of the showing the old light and the new light? Oh, I thought Mom was going to give that to you. Okay. Is there no way he can look at it right now, get it up, I guess? You didn't send it to him or anything?
I did, but I
won't. Oh, okay. Well, we won't worry about it, but we took a picture after we had the first one in. That's the one that was out, that one in the back, and after we'd replaced it, the difference was just amazing. The old ones then looked so dark and dingy, and, you know, I don't know how long it had been since they were changed, but we went to town and got LEDs that size and into the ceiling fans too, so hopefully they'll last till, well, if I'm still here when those go out, then you guys are in trouble. But anyhow, so all that just kind of gave it, I thought it gave it kind of a fresh, clean look, just that one change, the lighting change on all of this. So we'll call another work day someday and tackle the kitchen. We want to do things in the kitchen, but we're too tired, our feet and legs are too tired now after all that yesterday, so we'll wait. Well, without further ado, and I didn't even know there was dew when I got up this morning, or rain or anything, so let's get started. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here and to make some changes and make it a warm, inviting place, I hope, to come and worship you. And as we continue to do things to beautify the grounds, we do it primarily to be attractive to people that come by and see the church and see that there's a activity going on and that we're alive and well here, and hopefully that will cause them to want to stop and check us out, and not just for our sake but for the sake of hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he loved us enough to come and die for our sins and defeated death and sin by rising again. And that gives us the hope that we have to navigate this difficult, sad world that's so filled with evil and people who choose not to acknowledge you, just like we've preached in the first part of Romans that we're still looking at, that people fail to acknowledge you and they trade you for images that are cause them to be darkened in their minds and their hearts and to fall for things that are not right. So we ask you to be with us during these coming moments, during the service. Help us to honor and praise you with all that we do and say, and be with us as we eat dinner and fellowship and get to know each other a little better afterward. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I know when I woke up this morning, I felt every step of the ladder that I climbed yesterday. I didn't do anything. And it's a long ways up there, if you didn't know. And you get a different perspective of the church when you're up at the top of a ladder. We're going to start off with Bless the Name, Bless Be the Name. There we go. And it's hymn number 206, if you'd like to look at it in the hymnal. We're going to sing Love Lifted Me, which is hymn number 546. Despairing cry. Standing as we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, why don't you greet one another with a Bethel hug? You have a hug? Why are you being so bashful? Thank you. Hi. Got a hug? Oh my gosh, you're so big. You got money. Yeah. Money, money, money. Hello. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're up and around.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, gosh.
You got to get this.
Oh, And that was me. I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Very good. It's nice to hear some little kids singing that song. There's a lot of red, white, and blue here today. Have you noticed that? Jocelyn's got it on, and I've got it on, and it's all over in there, and there's some in here. You gonna come join us? You're gonna leave us? He's on a mission. Well, do you guys know what Monday is? It's a holiday. It's Memorial Day. And it's when we remember the people that have fought for our country and have given the ultimate sacrifice. And the ultimate sacrifice would be they gave their life. So those soldiers that gave their life to defend our country so that you and I could come to church today and worship God. Now that's a lot to be thankful for, because they didn't have to do that, but they wanted to do that because they loved America so much that they wanted us to be able to still have the freedom to be here and worship. And I think that's something that we need to remember. Now, my grandma used to call it Remembrance Day. They used to call it Remembrance Day. And I wish they still did, because I think that would make a little bit more sense. But anyway, they don't. But that's what Memorial Day is. It's remembering those people, those vets, those soldiers that gave their lives for us so that we could stay here and have freedom to worship God and to do the things that we do here in America. Because there's always people who are trying to take that away from us. And as you guys get older and older, you're going to find out that there are more and more people that are trying to take that away from us. And so as we remember those vets, those soldiers, this weekend, we need to thank the Lord for the ability to worship the way we are, the way we want to, and pray that we can continue to worship the way we want to. Okay? You think we can do that? And when you see the flag, or if you see a soldier, if you see a guy in a uniform or something, or a woman, you need to be sure to tell them, thank you for your service. Okay? And even if you see like a policeman or a fireman, you need to tell them, thank you for your service. Because it's a lot for them to do that. Okay? All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for the freedom that we have to worship you, and for those that have given their lives so that we can worship you the way, to have the freedom to worship you the way we want. And I just pray that we would continue to have that freedom and just watch over our country and guide us and direct us in all that we do. In your name I pray. Amen. Okay. You guys can go back and sit down. How many of you remember it called Remembrance Day? Nobody? Oh, just a few? Okay. My grandma always called it Remembrance Day, and it would always confuse me when I was little, but and I should have looked it up as when they changed it, but I didn't. But at some point in history, they changed it to Memorial Day, and that was that. Anyway, we're going to sing How Great Thou Art, which is hymn number 10. I don't know if Fred was going to do this, but I'm going to beat him to it if he was. Our next movie night is June the 16th. I don't know if you saw that on the slides or if it's in the bulletin. I don't know. I haven't even seen the bulletin. I don't even know what's going on half the time at my own house. Anyhow, it's the movie Courageous, and it's, like I said, it's on June the 16th, and that's the Friday right before Father's Day, and it is a it's geared towards fathers. So if you know some dads that you would really like to watch this movie, this is a great, great movie for them to see. It's about, basically, it's about dads taking, having the courage to be the spiritual leader in their home. And it's an awesome, awesome movie. It would be great if we could pack the church and start a revival of men coming to church and leading their families in worship and learning about God in their families. So I would encourage you to invite anybody that you know to come. We'll have snacks and popcorn and all that kind of stuff. So June the 16th at 7 o'clock, and it'll be great.
Yeah, I was going to say all of that. No, not really. I'm glad she did. I don't have to then. I won't mess it up. Let's have our tithes and offerings at this time. Yes, you can give too. Father, we come to this time of our service that we offer up our humbling offerings, being a part of what you've blessed us with and given to us. And we just ask you to accept it as our feeble attempt to give you some back to use for the furtherance of your kingdom by this church and to advance your name and give you honor and glory and to show our acknowledgement of you and our reverence of you and to also acknowledge your control in our lives. So we just thank you for those that have given and those that have given that aren't maybe not here today because of various things that people travel and there's so much going on at this time of year. And in this weekend, we especially remember those that gave their life to give us the opportunity to continue to live in a free country and continue to live in a country that, even though it's sadly straying in so many ways from you, that freedom of worship still exists. And people, there are still many, many people out there who do want to worship you and give you honor and glory, despite the evils that Satan throws at us and all of the negativity and the rejection of you that he injects into this world. So we thank you for all this, and we ask your blessings on these tithes and offerings, and help us to use it only according to your name and to give you honor and glory. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Holy Ghost. Thank you. You may be seated. Oh, can we show that clip? You got to get back there first, I guess. You can't make it start from here. The movie that Alana talked about, that what we decide on June 16th, Friday the 16th, you know, we were going to show Woodlawn, and we promoted that for a couple of weeks, and then with all the stuff going on with Nathaniel and everything else, we can't operate the service without him the way it is, because he does the slides and, you know, puts it all together after he picks out the music, and that's partially dependent on what he can play. So, but I can't play any of it, so we kind of go with what he likes and picks out. He does a great job picking out things that kind of go with the sermon so many times. This section of Romans that we've started on a week ago, and we're still in chapter 1, you know, it's looking like a long haul, isn't it, to get to the end of Romans, but I promise that some of them will go faster than this first couple of chapters do. But as I said last week, this is such a difficult topic for me, I don't know why, to preach on. You'll see when we get started here. But let us begin by, Nathaniel found a clip online to show a trailer for the movie that Alana was talking about. And that we haven't forgotten about Woodlawn. We'll just do it sometime here in the future. But this is the one that will be coming up on the 16th. It's a powerful movie. Friday night, the 16th, come show up. We'll have popcorn, and people always seem to bring treats. It was just supposed to be a kind of a like popcorn and snacks, you know, but it's almost turned into a meal with everybody brings good stuff, you know, to eat. But so it's fun. It's just casual. We sit out here and watch the movie and eat our popcorn, and it's a powerful movie, so I encourage you, if you can and want to, we'd love to have you come and watch the movie on the Friday the 16th. Well, we started, as I said last week, a topic that is just, I don't know why it's so difficult, but we started in Romans. We looked at the first part, 21 through 23 to start with. And we had been talking, you know, Paul had been talking in Romans about exchanging God for something that was basically worthless or certainly less than what we could do by worshiping God and being faithful to God and acknowledging Him. And this is kind of part two. And it'll be interesting to look at this from the few verses we read before and the verses we're going to read today to see that Paul repeats a few things three times in just that little short passage. So it must be important. And, you know, maybe the reason that it's difficult to talk about for me is because Satan throws this dark meaning to all this. And it is dark. And that's why it's difficult to talk about. And you know, there's a lot of churches across the nation that talk about something like this, and they get closed. They were closed down. They used it as an excuse a lot of times, COVID. But, you know, they've been closed down for this very reason, for talking about this topic. And a lot of churches, I think, as I read and see things online, they're kind of scared to talk about it anymore. Well, it's in God's Word, and if we're going through the book of Romans, I'm not going to leave out portions of it. I don't care how anybody thinks about it. You can call and have me arrested. I don't want to stay in jail, but, you know, I'd rather do that than to get up and leave parts of the Bible out or misconstrue them. And that's kind of what we talked about last week, how people try to tell the story and twist the meaning to where you can't really get to the truth because they've crafted such an effective argument to suit their agenda instead of what the truth really is. And let me start out by reading verses 24 through 28 that we read last week, 21 through 23. This is Romans 1, 24 through 28. So God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshipped and served the things God created instead of the Creator Himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the woman turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged with sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, He abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. Now, Paul's writing about this, and I mentioned last week, this isn't something new, although it's really come to the front in the last, 10, 20 years, even to the point where our legislatures have acknowledged that same-sex marriage and all of that kind of stuff is legal, sanctioned by the state. But it doesn't matter who sanctions what. If it's against God's will, then it's not right. It's wrong. So it's an illegitimate sanctioning of those kind of things, in my opinion. And I guess I kind of side with Paul on this, so I'm not completely alone in that thinking. And it's not a new thing. If Paul was talking about it being a big problem back then, it's been a problem for a long, long time. In fact, if you can go all the way back to the first recorded incident that I see in the Bible, it was with Abraham, you know, and his children. They wanted to introduce a little homosexuality in that. And I don't remember, I just kind of think, as I go up here, I didn't write it down or research it, but I believe it was one of the other children that came in, the other sons that came in and said, "You can't do that." And it wasn't full blown. It was just that tendency toward that. Go back and read the story of Abraham and can see about how that mention was made of that. So I think it goes all the way back to that and maybe before. I don't know, but it's not a new thing. And we talked about last week about how there's incidences in history. Even in 641, the bishops around the world gathered to say that that practice was incompatible with the scriptures as they read them and believed them. I won't go over all of that. But one of the big problems we have now is that people try to say, well, if that's how you were, that's your natural tendency or the way you were born, then to have that practice of homosexuality is okay. It's just if you're on the one side heterosexual and over here you have those relations, that's unnatural for you, and vice versa. If you're over here and you have heterosexual relations, that's unnatural. But if you're heterosexual and you maintain that practice, that's okay. And if you're over here homosexual and maintain that practice, that's okay. No, that's not right. That's an attempt to hide the truth. We studied a couple of weeks ago about hiding the truth, forsaking the truth of God, failing to acknowledge Him and our obedience which should be toward Him, to fall for a lie, to exchange Him is what we preached about that couple of weeks, to exchange the truth of God for a lie, to worship, and we just read here, to worship the creation, each other's, instead of the true God, the true Creator. And that's what we're going to finish talking about today. Let me flip on over. I don't want to go over all of last time's. You guys will be getting hungry and want to go eat instead of having to listen through all that again. Those, Paul said that those that wanted to act unusually toward their bent, that is the problem with that lifestyle. And Paul said, no, that's not the problem. It's clear, man and woman were made for that practice, not to exchange for each other. But Paul was saying in the verses that we read last week and started out with in this, you know, he said, well, in verse 18, run from sexual sin. No other sin so clearly affects the body as this does. For sexual immorality is a sin against your own body. Your body is, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body. And that's particular sayings of Paul to the Romans about this particular issue. But that's not the only issue. There's all kinds of things that we do. We exchange that for God, letting it get a hold of our lives. Back in those days, they talked about idols a lot. We exchange the worship of an idol. Well, we say, well, we don't have a golden calf or a, you know, a whatever bejeweled statue of some kind that we worship. No, but we have our idols. It could be our bank account, our money. Nothing wrong with having money, but if that's your idol and you worship that and you put that above everything else, then yes, it's wrong. Remember what Jesus told the rich young ruler? He said, go sell all your possessions and give it to the poor and then come back and see me. You know, and that wasn't because those possessions were wrong. It was because that was how he was wrapped up in. That was his soul security blanket, was what he had. Jesus saying, you got to follow me and worship me. And the only way for you to do that, to that young ruler, is to get rid of your possessions you're trusting in and start over from scratch, basically, is what he was saying. He wasn't saying we all need to go out and sell our possessions. We'd all have to get together here and sleep on the pews, I guess. We wouldn't have a home. We wouldn't have anything. That's not what Jesus was saying. People try to say things like that, though, and make a mockery of what Jesus said, too. So there's plenty of people out there that want to reject God. And remember, a couple of weeks ago, we read that scripture about, you know, trading the knowledge of God and saying that that is what catches so many people. They fall for that because they don't know the truth. That's what we're supposed to do. That's why God's left us here. He didn't zap us up into heaven. He leaves us here to go through our natural life to be the purveyors of the truth. And that's why we're still here. We're supposed to influence our little area of society by standing for what's right. We don't have to go preaching to them, and that turns them off a lot of times, beating them over the head with the Bible. But just the way we live and the way we act and the way we respond to other people and respond to situations, that's how we convey what we believe in, taking a stand for the right, not giving in and go along with the crowd. I know some of you don't have Facebook, but and they don't put it up there much anymore, but used to, it was right on your home page. Your quote, you choose a quote and put it on. And I have, you know, it's been accredited to several different people through history, but the one I still have up there on my Facebook page is that right is right, even if no one is doing it, and wrong is wrong, even if everyone is doing it. And that is just so true, you know, and our society has rejected that type of accountability or reasoning or thinking. Well, so to wrap up and get ready to finish up here, to wrap up what we've been talking about, that is not what we're doing right now, but human beings exchange God for what God has made, or for images of God that is ourselves. We are created in the image of God. It tells us that in the very beginning. And as we've talked about many times, that is not one single, I don't know if God looks like any one single one of us. I doubt it. I hope he doesn't look like me. It'd be a sad place, but we are created in the image of God with the ability to think, reason, figure things out, stand upright and use hands with opposable thumbs and grab things and build things and make things. That's all the image of God. Not talking about outer looks, but abilities, capabilities, things that God created us with that none of the other animals have. And by the way, when you want to talk about the animals, you don't see very many of them. They do exhibit once in a while a behavior that would seem that way, but basically it takes a female and a male to procreate and produce and move forward, and that's what you see in the natural world. Now, I used to, when I was even not as smart, I'm not very smart today, but even lesser smart, I'd get into arguments with people, and they will blast you and argue, and they'll even come up. There was one time, I think the only legitimate one I found was, there was some obscure bat that lives somewhere, I don't know where, and they really, I guess, truly exhibited homosexual tendencies and behaviors. But if that's in the millions of species that are alive on the earth, that's all you can find is one little bat, obscure, relatively hardly even there, you know, hard to find bat, then that doesn't convince me of anything. So we exchange God for what God has made. We prefer the creature to the creator. the Creator with a capital C, being God himself. And as we see in Israel's history, and as we're told throughout this particular section that we will read and we have been reading in Romans, God gives us over to what we prefer. Remember Israel. God was Israel's king for a long time. Finally, they objected, so God said, okay, I'll give you a king. And, of course, King Saul came after that. He said, but when you get an earthly king, you're going to also have to pay taxes and get drafted into his army. So nothing wrong with paying some taxes, not overly taxed, and nothing wrong with serving in the military at all. In fact, that's an honorable thing, and that's one of the things we honor today is people that have served and given their life so we can sit here in freedom and worship the way we want to worship or not worship at all. You don't have to do anything, but that's the freedom that has been preserved by the people that gave the ultimate sacrifice for us. But we see throughout time, King Saul's only one example where God said, okay, well, here's what you want, but here's the consequences. It comes with strings, you know, unless you have me as your guide and your wisdom and to follow, then you're going to have to suffer some consequences for that, for your rejection of me. And it wasn't because of not worshiping him, not doing that, but it's because the overall picture is the rejection of him or the failure to acknowledge him. Maybe it's just you're apathetic and you didn't physically, visually, or concretely reject God. You just ignored him. And that's kind of what some of the verses had said here that we have been reading. And the third thing that we can get from all that is kind of what I just referred to, that God hands us over, but it's because this lifestyle that we choose, whether it's heterosexual or homosexual, is a dramatization of our inner spiritual condition of trading God, our fallen human soul, the exchange of God for the images of our own selves in this particular case. Paul goes through that. If you take what we started with last week on this topic, as we finish it up, he goes through it a couple more times in that passage. They exchanged the glory of God for an image in the form of corruptible man. It said in verse 23 that we read last week. God gave them over in the lusts of their heart to impurity. Well, we read that here in verse 24. So that their bodies would be dishonored among them, was also at the end of verse 24. That pattern repeats three times through this chapter, first chapter of Romans, and other references to it too also. I was going to pass out. I don't know. Maybe I will do that right now. Huh? I'm not going to pass out. I pass these out, I should say. Yeah. I don't know. Let me just hand some out here. Can you take one and pass it back? And I don't know if I kept enough for this side. You want one, or I don't know if he wants one, or I researched that a couple years ago and made that list of scriptures, and I thought if some of you don't have it, you could have another one here. And just a they're not all scriptures which directly say what we're talking about, but it shows the pattern. It's some backup stuff of the pattern that substantiates what Paul is saying here about this lifestyle that is called an abomination in the King James and some of the other translations, and a normal lifestyle. And the normal lifestyle is only the heterosexual lifestyle. So, I just thought I'd pass those out. You can look at them at your... Yeah, I thought I would pass those out, not pass out. And you can look at them at your convenience or whatever. And I might mention, I made note in here that in my notes that AIDS, which everybody said, oh, that's the punishment, you know, that's whatever for the homosexuality. Paul's theme centers around the fact that that's just a consequence of it. AIDS is not the ultimate punishment. The ultimate punishment is the rejection of God and the separation from the norm, from what God approves of, the type of life he created us for. It's not there. And that's the problem, not AIDS. That's the symptom of that rejection of God and trading God for a creation or an idol or whatever it may be. So in verse 25, Paul repeats again, the second time through these same three sets of steps. They exchange the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator who is blessed forever. We just got through reading that in verse 25. And it's a repeat of verse 23 where it said, he said they exchanged the glory of God for images. The truth of God is that he is glorious and to be desired above all things. The lie is that we humans, as a creature, one of the creatures, are more desirable for each other than God. God, if we worship God and keep him first in our life and the center of our life, not just first, but the center of everything in our life, then that's how he created us. And again, you only have to look at the nature around us, animals, to see that that's the ideal. Just because we get to, and you remember the thing that we look at to say, well, we're smarter than God. We can figure out how we want to take care of our lives. Maybe not that we're smarter than God, but we're just smart enough to take care of ourselves. See how that worked out for Adam and Eve. That was kind of the beginning of all of this. Their rejection, maybe not a total rejection of God, but just change it a little bit. And that's the subtle thing that Satan does. He gives you 90 or 95% of the truth, but he throws just a little bit of error in there. And I've seen the example, maybe not a good example, but I say things that aren't good up here all the time. So, you know, if you cook some, and I saw some show over the past week, one evening or something, that where you cook, take a little bit, you go out in the backyard and scoop up what your dog leaves behind, put a little bit of that in some chocolate brownies. Then do you want to eat any of those chocolate brownies? No. And, oh, she made chocolate brownies today, but we didn't do that, so don't worry when you get back for the lunch. I just thought of that when I started telling this story, though. They'll go back there and see those brownies and say, I don't know. But the point is that's just a little bit. That's what Satan does. He puts all the good stuff in there, all the sugar in the mix and all that, but just throws one little bit of something in there that we don't want. And that's, you know, 90% good stuff, 95% good stuff, 5% lie. That's how he starts to suck us in. And then the lies get more and more frequent until we're so far off track. You know, it's just like shooting an arrow. For those of you that are hunters, if you shoot an arrow and it's that much off here, by the time it gets to the back of this church, it's going to be that much off. And that's how Satan operates. He starts off with, almost can't tell the difference, imperceptible. Go back and read the account, you know, of Eve. Eve got nervous when the Satan approached her as that serpent. And the serpent said, Satan himself said, God didn't really say that you'll die if you eat of that tree, which is what God did say. But Eve responded by saying, he said we're not to touch, not to eat of that one tree or even touch it. God didn't say anything about touching it. He just said don't eat from it. And so that was 90% of the truth. God didn't say you shouldn't eat of that tree. But somehow that confused Eve, and so she got that little bit of lie infused. And he did it. Satan did it. He caused her mind to be confused. And then, as I've said before up here, we don't want to blame Eve completely because Adam was supposed to be the ultimate end. That's where the buck stopped with Adam. Not that he was superior, but he was responsible for, like at home, if there's a controversy or something, you don't get out a baseball bat and beat your wife or your husband. You try to figure out the way to go forward with that. And that's what Satan did. He confused her. And then Adam didn't have the fortitude to stand up and say no. He said, okay, yeah, it looks good. He was supposed to put a stop to it right there. Of course, sin wouldn't have failed to come into this world because somebody would have done something. I always say, even if it was perfect up till now, I would have messed it up for all of us. So, but even Adam and Eve did it. They were both equally complicit with that, and they introduced sin. And I don't think that was a surprise to God. God wanted us to exist and to learn how to worship Him, how to choose Him in the first place. When we had a choice, we could stay away from God under the law of sin that envelops this entire world, or we could choose God. We still have to go through all these things. He delivers us sometimes, but we can't demand that that always be the case. It happens according to God's will and His plan for us and our lives. So, anyhow, that's way off my notes. As always, Danny laughs every time. He knows that I don't have a clear path toward the end of the sermon. I'm like this, you know. Okay, good. Misery loves company or something like that. Well, the third time through that same sequence was in verse 28. They did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, which corresponds to both 23 and 25 that we talked about, both of those just a couple of minutes ago. They exchanged the glory of God for images, Paul's saying. The third time he repeats this. Then God gave them over to a depraved mind. There's that God gave them over again, as I talked about, you know, with Israel starting way back there. And that happened so many times through their history. They would get up on a high and get where they should be. You get comfortable with whatever it is that is making you feel comfortable, and you fall. And God would have to come rescue them. And as I've said, it goes up even through the New Testament. Perfect example being Peter getting out of the boat and trying to walk on the water toward Jesus, and as soon as he looked down at the waves, he started to sink. He was okay as long as he had his eyes on Jesus. What a perfect example of what we talk about. Staying away from sin, and when we get caught into sin or get our eyes off of Jesus, we start to sink into sin. As soon as we look up, we don't even have to look up. Jesus reaches down and pulls us up. So it's a lesson to us to keep our eyes on Him and not be distracted. Satan's pretty wily. He's had 6,000 years practice. I don't think anyone in here has been around 6,000 years. If you have, I want to talk to you after the service, and we'll call the TV crews and stuff. But I haven't been around 6,000 years. I wasn't there to learn those lessons. But Satan has had that many years plus whatever to practice and how to delude us, so he can draw us off to his side a lot of times that we don't even realize it until we're stuck in that path. I think it's a lot like drug use. You're using illicit drugs, legal or illegal, and you become addicted and you get drawn. You don't become addicted the first time, but after a repeated drug use, pretty soon you realize, I'm addicted, I can't quit. Same with, I'm talking about drugs, I can talk about anything. You know, if you use it the way it's supposed to be used, and there's medicinal purposes for a lot of those things, I'm talking, you know, alcohol and drugs and everything, and even Jesus turned water into the wine. Now, that's a whole another discussion about what that wine consisted of, but I think that if you had, in their case, they had bad water, so yeah, obviously, it was okay to have a little wine, but if you get so drunk you can't walk down the street, and you know, that's a different thing. You can't drive, you hit somebody, you kill somebody, hurt yourself, maybe kill yourself. There's all those things that factor into that. And I'm not here to promote any kind of drug use or any kind of whatever use. I'm just here to say that I think in the right setting and very, very moderate, you know, Jesus participated in that too. That's a dangerous thing to say. I don't want to say that. Well, I think you know what I'm trying to say. Just a little bit, a little moderation. Take it easy. You know, it's okay. get out of control. And I had a former pastor, we had a former pastor that said, you know, you as a deacon or as an elder or whatever your church calls you, if you're called to that, you don't want to be at the end and then you think, well, it's 11 o'clock at night, nobody's going to care. But if somebody in trouble calls you as a representative of the church, you have to have a clear mind, be okay enough to have a clear mind and be able to respond and help out in that situation to show your Christian attitude and Christian life. And again, I hope you know what I'm trying to say. We could spend three or four weeks on that subject, and if I don't quit, we won't even get to have dinner today. So he gave them over. That was in verse 28, which corresponds to 24 and 26 we just read. And then to do those things that aren't proper, the end of verse 28, which also corresponds with the end of verse 24 and the end of 26 and all of 27. That theme is repeated three times, and that means Paul thought it was important for us to grasp. And in closing, then, out of those verses, Paul said, the deepest problem of our lives, whether it's heterosexual or homosexual, is the terrible exchange of the glory of God for the images of the created, which is us. So when we switch from the lifestyle that God ordained to other lifestyles, especially the one we're talking about today, I think that is so wrong because it's so visible. It's a visible destruction of the family. There's other things you can do that no one else knows about, or just maybe a few, but that one's public. Everybody's going to know. And the family was the first institution created by God, so I feel like that's a terrible thing from our perspective, terrible destruction of God's will. Second, the disordering of our lives, and that's basically what it is. We forsake the normal order for that order. It's a disordering of our lives. It's the judgment of God on the human race. It's not the things that result from that, like AIDS and those kind of things. It's that disordering that is the failure to recognize God. That is the exchange of the glory of God for other things. Let me read right quick Romans 5, 15 to 18, and then we'll get out of here pretty quick. But there is a great difference between Adam's sin and God's gracious gift. For the sin of this one man, Adam, brought death to many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of forgiveness to many through this other man, Jesus Christ. And the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of that one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation. But God's free gift leads to our being made right with God, even though we are guilty of many sins. For the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of righteousness for all who receive it will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. Yes, Adam's one sin brings condemnation for everyone, but Christ's one act of righteousness brings a right relationship with God and a new life for everyone. And then I won't read the whole thing, but in Romans 8, verse 18, it says, yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. For all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who his children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. Talking about creation, against its will, was subjected to the evil of sin. But God, and Romans 18 that we spent a week on, but God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. That is exactly what this sin does. It causes God's anger, and it will be come to fruition someday. God's patient. He's allowing this world to still exist, but it won't forever. From the beginning, then, we can read in Genesis, manhood and womanhood existed to represent God's relation to his people, and then Christ's relation to his bride, the church. Have you ever thought of it like that? Man and woman are to be, it's a direct correlation with Christ and his bride, the church, the family. I mean, you can't get away from the family. God the Father, Jesus the Son, we're the children of God. We're going to be joint heirs as if we are adopted. We are adopted by God, and when you're adopted, you have equal rights with the other children. We're the children. The family of God, I mean, it goes on and on. It's the family unit that God sanctioned best, and this is a perversion. This is exactly what we've been talking about a couple of weeks. The trading, the exchanging of God for something that is worthless, something that is evil and causes actions, as we read about women and women and men, that are detestable. But our society is so strong, so bent on approving these things, and all this transgender stuff and everything is kind of an outreach of that type, that frame of reference of evil that exists, the family unit. If the devil can break up the family unit, man, he's gone a long ways toward having a lot of people join him in hell, suffering hell for eternity. And like I said, I would like to skip over this thing. It's a difficult topic, but when Paul talked about it three times, the same as when Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you," and when he repeated some words, it meant, this is important. Wake up, put your sandwich down, you know, quit doing whatever you're doing and pay attention. And that's what Paul was doing here, repeating this theme three times. He was saying, this is important. This is a very destructive thing that we're talking about, and you better pay attention. And I tend to agree that if it's repeated, and you know, the really difficult things, passages are about important things that they've repeated and say, pay attention, pay attention. Well, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your instruction, those that may be easy and those that may be difficult in our society, because we really don't want to make people mad and offend them. We want them to see the error of their way, just like sometimes we need people to point out the errors of our way. We all have sins of all kinds, different ones. Some are recurring, some are just one time, but we all have a tendency to want to sin. That's Satan. That's not us. It's not a guilt trip. That's just what Satan does to draw us off and try to condemn us. He can't win the battle, the war, but he wants to win some battles. So I pray that we can apply these things to our lives and know how to react to people or how to respond when someone may question our faith or how we live, and that we can provide words of encouragement and maybe comfort or in a loving way instruction to the people around us who have whatever sin that oppresses them in their life. So we ask you to give us the wisdom to respond rightly, yet stand firm on what you've told us is the truth. We ask this thing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, we're going to sing The Family of God, which is hymn number 386. And I'm sure most of you have it memorized. Let's go eat.